Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have Kathleen Almon, part one. We'll hear a pro-life reflection from Emily Albrecht and much more. Welcome to Life on the Rock. Tonight, our guest is Kathleen Almon. She's with Mission Youth. And this is an organization that's had a big impact on a lot of people, 24 countries around the world. And a lot of times, it's a lot of young people, high schoolers, but it's for all ages, it's for families to get involved and to do some mission work. And they find it helps their own faith and helps the community.
Yeah, Mission Youth, it is about building faith. And especially with young people, they're looking for an adventure, but they're also looking to make a difference in the local community, but also in their own faith life. So we're now going to a pro-life reflection with Emily Albrecht.
My junior year of college, I spoke at our outreach table with a girl named Anna. Anna was coming out of class one day and just stopped by our table. She had a really run-of-the-mill kind of bodily autonomy, my body, my choice kind of a view. And I had the opportunity to talk to her for about 30 minutes. And I'll be honest, I didn't think that it was that spectacular of a conversation. She had to go off to class and I kind of forgot about it. Until about a month later, she found me on Facebook. We were not friends on Facebook, but she found me spontaneously and she sent me a Facebook message and said, "Hey, I have to write a paper for a class. I was wondering if I could interview you." I was like, "Of course you can. Okay, sure." So we met for pizza and I will never forget the very first thing she said to me. We sat down, she looks across the table and she goes, "I haven't been able to stop thinking about that argument you made." She had been having an argument that I had made buzz around in her head for a month, so much so that she felt the need to reach out to me. She wanted to interview me for a class, yes, but more than that, she wanted to like go back and forth and engage with more arguments because something I had said had so impacted her that now she wanted to have more conversation. You see, most people don't change their mind in a day. They change their mind when they have an opportunity to think things through, when they have the opportunity to look back and reflect. And so I sat with her that day for 3 hours, and we talked through a ton more pro-choice arguments, and at the end, she sat back in her chair and said, "You know, I can't believe I'm saying this, but I think I have to be pro-life now. Could you teach me again about that argument you made like 30 minutes ago? Because my parents are pro-choice, and I want to go teach it to them, because I think I can change their mind too." That is the power of having these conversations, even conversations you didn't think were that remarkable, conversations that you thought just kind of ended and they didn't really change their mind. You don't know what God is doing in that time in between. A lot of the people I've talked to didn't change their mind in front of my face, but Anna reminds me that I don't know what happens behind closed doors. I don't know what God does with their hearts, and it is entirely possible that they changed their mind later because Anna did.
Kathleen Almon, welcome to Life on the Rock.
Thank you so much, Father Mark.
And I was first impressed by how big Mission Youth is. How large internationally is the organization?
So Mission Youth, as an apostolate of Regnum Christi, it is present in 24 countries around the world. And at least during our Holy Week missions, it engages about 40 to 50,000 missionaries worldwide.
Wow. And you're located in the Atlanta area. How big is it in the United States?
In the United States, we have 6 cities that have stable mission teams, and about 20 different cities organize Holy Week missions every year. Mm-hmm.
And you're a consecrated member of Regnum Christi, and you feel like this is a special expression of the charism of Regnum Christi and
yes.
The work of its organization?
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah. So Regnum Christi as a spiritual family has the legionaries of Christ and consecrated men and women and lay people. And there's many apostolates that individually those different groups can do. And this particular mission apostolate is really special for us because it's one that the whole spiritual family of Regnum Christi can participate in together. So the legionaries and the lay people and the consecrated men and women can all do a mission experience together. Right. And in my personal opinion, I think that's what makes it especially fruitful for the church.
Yeah, because you can marshal like a lot of prayer power behind the work, right?
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Now, let's talk about the nitty-gritty of what Mission Youth is. You know, what do you all do? What does it look like in a very simple way?
Yep, so the simple goal of Mission Youth is really to be a response to Pope John Paul II's call to the new evangelization. So it's a desire to provide young people and families with an opportunity to partner with their local parishes.
And let me stop you there. You said it did come out of Denver World Youth Day, right?
Yes.
Were you present there?
Personally, I was not present.
Okay.
No, I was too young to attend.
Well, so many apostolates we have that we interview on the show is like, there's oftentimes, a lot of times, there's connections to Denver. It's had a huge impact on the church in America.
It has. It's really, really, really special. Yeah.
But you take that message of evangelization seriously, and so what does it look like? I'm sorry I interrupted you.
No, yeah. It's okay. No, yeah. It's okay, because in the closing mass of Denver, John Paul II made this rally cry to all the young people to go out to the streets and public places and proclaim the faith like the first apostles. So that was what the goal of this apostolate sought to do, was to provide young people and families an opportunity to do that. So it was started up in 1995, and it's taken different names and forms, but the goal is really to partner with local parishes and to go out in the community to be able to reach out to Catholics or to local community needs and really connect them back to the parish and back to the local community.
And I thought that is very wise, too, because like the pastor there has a deep sense of the needs of that area. Mm-hmm. So you all are working with the parish and to some degree, more or less, with the pastor, right? And I think, and you can marshal like resources of the parish, right, in helping you.
Yes, it is really beautiful to have the whole community involved, because Mission Youth is not a church, it's not a parish, it's really just a network of missionaries.
Right.
So they can come in and be like the arms and feet and smiles and enthusiasm to really bring forward a community need or to support a pastor with a concrete pastoral need.
And, you know, it's been said that, you know, any kind of revolution or whatever in the world, even in a worldly sense, is always has to involve like young people, right? And one thing I like about Life on the Rock, oftentimes we interview a lot of young people, and I think, you know, they might not have the wisdom of the elderly, but they have an energy, and I think even more important, they have a detachment that are they're available. And they have an idealism, right, that they want to do something good with their life, they want to have a change, they want to have impact. And Mission Youth taps into all this, right? And so many other groups do, too. But is that what you see?
Definitely. Yeah. I think a lot of the young people that come on our missions, really what they're looking for is adventure. They're looking for something different, and they want to make a real difference in someone's life today. So we want to provide them with an in-person encounter with people, whether it's through a street mission or homeless ministry or door-to-door evangelization, but that in-person contact and giving a young person a chance to speak with someone and to witness to their faith is really a very big adventure for many of them.
Right. And I would imagine, we're talking about high schoolers, middle school too?
And college, families and young adult, really any age can participate in this.
Right. And so some of them are coming to participate in a mission that might not have a very strong faith or a very deep understanding of the faith or even very much of a lived faith.
Yep, that's very true.
And what does it look like and what's the experience like for them?
So it can be very intimidating at first because they can think, I need to be rattling off Bible quotes, or I need to have my catechism in my back pocket to go and be a missionary. So when we're training them, one of the things I like to help them see is that really it's very simple to be a missionary, that they are there to be a witness and remind people of three things, that God is real, that God is with them, and that God loves them. And to kind of show their Catholic faith in the way that they live more than the words that they say. And when I explain that to people, I see this huge sense of relief because they're like, oh, I can do that, right? And as the mission day goes on, it's beautiful to see how their own prejudices about maybe even what the faith is suddenly kind of breaks down when they experience God in an encounter with another person. And they come back to the church at the end of the mission day to pray for the people they met and to have an encounter with a priest themselves, and it really renews and strengthens their faith because they've just spent the whole day witnessing to it.
Right. And I think about the Gospels, like Jesus sending out 72 ahead of them. You know, how much did they know, right, at that point? And, you know, how articulate with the faith, but they went out and did, and the Holy Spirit was working with them and through them to prepare for Jesus coming to the village or whatever. And it just seems like, you know, our young people can do that. They could be like part of the 72. Well, let's talk about the practicalities. So you mentioned that there's a day mission. It could be like a Saturday connected to a parish. A whole family could go. Mm-hmm. High schoolers could go. And what do they do on a Saturday?
So it varies a little bit depending on the location. But I can take Atlanta, for example, that has monthly day missions that they offer for high schoolers and college students. That's run very, very well. And so they gather usually downtown, either in the Basilica or a school or a university center that's willing to receive them. And they gather together for some training and some fellowship and some prayer time. Sometimes we're even able to start with Mass, because that's really important as missionaries to fill ourselves up with God first and to kind of feel connected with the missionary community, to know that we're not alone, we're not doing something crazy by ourselves. And then we go divide up into teams, each one kind of led by a mission guide that kind of facilitates the team and models for them how to be a missionary. And they go out. This particular mission, they really do street evangelization, particularly serving the homeless that they meet. And their goal is to encounter the people in a deep way and a personal way, the ones that are willing to offer them a human need, whether that's a bottle of water or a sandwich, and to speak to them as a human person and connect with their needs and ask them if they have something that they can pray for.
Okay, well, we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back and finish what else that they do. So back in just a moment. So Kathleen, they're trying to, like in the case of street evangelization, maybe in a poor area, to meet a human need, you said, bottle of water, sandwich. And I was thinking too, like, that could be part of the parish too, making sandwiches in the morning, or the group itself making sandwiches and bringing that out to get a lot of people involved in this.
That's 100% true. And whenever there's a mission day, maybe there's 30 to 40 young people on a mission, but there's a whole network of people behind them that make the mission possible. Right. So a lot of the donations, a lot of whether that's financial donations or material donations, are provided by the families, by the local community or the local parish that know about the mission, and maybe they can't go in person, but they just want to be a part of it. And they know that the young people will bring these things to the hands of those that really need it.
So in case of like high schoolers going out, there would be an adult that would accompany them. And they provide training. What does the training look like?
So right now what we have is we try to centralize everything on our website, and we have their training videos, and you can download a mission guidebook, and that kind of gives you the nuts and bolts of what you would need to start a mission. Honestly, for me, the best training is to go on a mission yourself. Because by experiencing it, then you feel equipped to then go and bring it back to your own parish or community.
So you would have, I'm just thinking young people specifically, but they would have like returning members too that could show the new guys the ropes, right?
100%. Most of our mission guys are kind of mission junkies that go again and again and again because they love it so much.
Now, what about if you're in a wealthy suburb of Atlanta and you're going door to door? What does that look like? How do you get through the gated community, or how does that look? What does that look like?
It's definitely can be challenging at times. Because it's sometimes easier to sit down on the curb next to a homeless person that has an obvious need and to be able to connect with them. But every single human heart has the need for God. And sometimes it's not as obvious, but that doesn't make it less real. So we try, if we're going to a more suburbia or normal neighborhood and we're knocking on doors, we try to have that same gentle approach of introducing ourselves and asking if there's a need that we can pray for them without necessarily coming across with them in an evangelization message directly. And that normally opens the door for someone to share a need that's on their heart, whether that's a family member with cancer or a situation that they're struggling with. And you're not asking for anything as a missionary other than to know their need so that you can pray for them. And that usually offers an opportunity for a deeper conversation or an invitation to come to Mass or to talk with a priest.
And in the suburbs, do you encounter, do you meet a lot of the people Catholic, or a lot of people, do they have some faith, or they have, or they haven't been to church in a long time? What is the typical?
There's a little bit of everything. A little bit of everything. But I have seen over and over again how God seems to take advantage that the missionaries are there. And we have encountered people that For example, one gentleman this summer, when we were outside of Denver, he was going to go and receive the results of his cancer diagnosis the day after we had visited his house. And so he asked us, can you pray for me? And can you come back on Friday so that I can tell you what the results were?
Oh, wow.
And we had just met him that day, right?
Yeah.
Or another gentleman that we were crossing on the sidewalk, and he was actually a Mormon missionary. Mm-hmm. And we sat on the sidewalk for an hour with this young man and exchanged differences about the Catholic faith and the Mormon faith and what did he believe. And he was authentically curious and so happy that he could find Catholics to be able to explain their faith to him.
Right. And I would think like the women in the group maybe could be very, almost better getting people to trust initially to stand at the door and open it fully or something.
I mean, honestly, the best ones are the children because they have no fear.
And then also, and like in terms of like, you were telling me earlier about the, maybe like a street people, homeless people, that you go in with some contacts with local help, right? Mm-hmm. If they have like addiction issues or financial issues or food issues, what does that look like?
Definitely. Mission Youth doesn't pretend to be experts in working with homeless people or drug addicts because our missionaries aren't necessarily equipped with all of that experience.
Right.
So we always want to partner with a local organization that is doing ongoing work with them, whether it's a drug rehab center, a Salvation Army, St. Vincent de Paul. And we want to be able to meet these people where they're at and then refer to them where they can find the help that they need. Because our goal as missionaries is to give them an experience of God's love and to remind them that God is with them and where they can find that spiritual nourishment. But at the same time, being able to point them to who can help them with those human needs.
Right.
So I've definitely had the experience of accompanying men off the street that were ready to check themselves off into rehab. And it's a beautiful experience of witnessing that moment of grace when they're willing to go and get the help that they need.
And as we mentioned before, you're working in conjunction with the parish to some degree. And what is the impact on the parish and maybe on the priest? Well, like COVID, you mentioned to me some problems with COVID. What have the pastors told you about that?
Definitely. So with here in the States, with the reality of COVID and people not attending their parish and Sunday Mass for some people for almost 2 years, it is a reality that creates a habit. So I've received several emails or phone calls from pastors saying, I need missionaries that can go and invite people to come back to Mass, that they're not scared anymore that the sacraments are here, because many parishes don't have that network of people to be able to invite people back. Right. So it's been a beautiful partnership with many parishes to go and do that, to knock on doors and just invite people to come back to Mass or to come back to their parish community, right? And it's also just a beautiful thing when we can go to a pastor with this offer of, we can help train missionaries or bring missionaries to your parish. Is there a concrete need that you see, particularly around the time of Holy Week? Is there a liturgy that you would like to invite people to? Do you need something to do with your young people? And one concrete mission leader that we have in Dallas, he approached a parish that had tons of young adults that he thought would be great for mission work. And so when he asked the pastor, what do you need? He was like, well, I need someone on my parish council. Can you be on my parish council? So this young man joined the parish council, understood the needs of the parish, and then was able to offer Mission Youth as a program to be able to assist with some concrete needs. So the pastor is so happy with the contribution of this young man and also the enrichment of bringing the apostolate to his parish as a way to engage all the young people that are there.
And generally, what do the pastors tell you about the impact of Mission Youth?
So the biggest thing is that they notice that the missionaries are full of joy, that it just brings so much joy to the parish, and it unites the parish around a project that maybe not everyone can participate in directly, but even if they can't, they want to be involved by offering their prayers. They want to offer their home so the missionaries can stay there. They want to offer donations for the homeless or pizza for the missionaries. So everyone in the parish can contribute in some way, even if they can't go directly out onto the streets and knock on doors.
Well, Kathleen, this is the first show. We're going to do a second show with you, but thank you so much for joining us on Life on the Rock, and we have a lot more to talk about, so we'll see you next week on Life on the Rock.
Thank you, Father Mark.
I enjoyed my conversation with Kathleen. One of the points I like was how they very much plug in to the parish, and And, you know, maybe the pastor has time and things he can really get involved with this, but also to help just direct him, hey, I got this need, right? And for in terms of evangelization and then the group can respond. I thought that was great.
And I think too, one of the things I like about Mission Youth is that it does get people active and involved, because we can a lot of times become robots, you know, in religion. Things become very almost just mechanical. It's just there's a routine, but we never really branch out, kind of stretch the horizon and kind of actually see what God has in plan for us and the work that we can do. And I think a lot of times whenever we do kind of start young, whenever, especially in our teenage years, you know, that's the time when God's really forming us. He's molding us into becoming that Christian disciple. And to have that experience and training, to have that one-on-one encounter with the people we meet on the streets, you know, that goes a long way, because, you know, a lot of times we are in a broken world, you know, there's problems, but we're encountering that. We're bringing the message, that gospel message, into the hearts of people that have probably never had that, you know, message proclaimed to them, or maybe have never even been loved. So it's really important to really foster that Christian discipleship.
Yeah, maybe it's a danger for us in the church that we forget about the power of the gospel.
Right, yeah.
The power of that proclamation, that word goes out, it has an effect, it has an impact. And that can stir our faith when we see it in action, we see it at work in somebody's life. It encourages us, and certainly it's our work as Catholics and to go out and give that message. But that power is there. It, you know, with the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that power is woven, as Pope Francis says, woven throughout history, and it comes up. You cannot keep it down. So we're tapping into that, right? And I like, too, that you can do it as a family. Yeah. I thought that was a great aspect of this, that the family could go on a Saturday and all be part of this. Yeah. What a strengthening thing.
I think, too, one of the other key aspects was that, you know, God is real, God is with us, and God loves us. Such a simple message, but how far removed we can be in our thinking towards God, that God is real, and that God is with us, or that God, you know, loves us. We forget that, you know, that God is really drawn near to us through the Passion, through the Incarnation, through His death and resurrection, that He has made something so awesome for us. But again, you know, a lot of times we are kind of broken by sin, you know, we're driven away from what is the real truth in our life. And that is God. It is at the end of this life, we will be reunited with God. You know, we can't ever lose sight of that, but it is easy to lose sight of.
Right. And it's a message that needs to be proclaimed in the flesh. How can they believe unless they see something or experience something of the presence of God in us and bringing that to them?
Yeah.
So we'll send you into that world with a blessing and a prayer of the Holy Spirit to strengthen you, to guide you, to give you every good gift and grace. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We'll see you next week on Life on the Rock.
Lately I've been thinking just how everything is changing, like a constant rearranging in the dark. We live, we laugh, we grow apart, we ache to fill these hungry hearts. A race that leads us right back to the start. Oh, I want a joy that has no limits, a love that never ends. And I want a hope with no beginning, just one forever friend to hold. Some moments are so beautiful, yet they elude my grasp. Like sand sifting between my hands, why can't I make it last? I long to live with no regrets, to seek a sun that never sets, to feel alive in heart and mind, and never to forget the